Okay, good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to our weekly seminar in the Department of Marine Geosciences. We're very honored to host today Dr. Aurel Perşoiu from the Emil Racoviță Institute of Speleology, Romanian Academy in Cluj-Napoca in Romania. Aurel is a senior scientist in the Emil Racoviță Institute of Speleology in Cluj-Napoca. His work unfolds at the intersection of car science, stable isotopes, geochemistry, and paleoclimatology, aiming to disentangle the various processes associated to the dynamics of the global water cycle, understand plus climate variability, and how these affect human societies. Aurel uses modern links between climate variabilities and the stable isotope composition of precipitation water to track past seasonality, climate change with focus on the Holocene, as these are recorded by the geochemistry of cave ice deposits, speleotems, and tree rings. His studies carried him from caves in the high Arctic to Antarctica, South America, and most karst regions in Europe. He holds a bachelor and a master degrees in geomorphology from the Babes Bolvai University in Cluj-Napoca, and a PhD in geology from the University of Southern Florida. So Aurel is going to talk today about the seasonality does matter, disentangling winter and summer climate changes during the past 5,000 years, and assess their role in the dynamic of human societies in Southern East Europe. So Aurel, the podium is yours.
Yes. Thank you very much, Nicolas, and thank you everybody for being here to listen to this talk. It's a pleasure for me actually to talk about these kind of things, because I really enjoy doing what I'm doing, and I also enjoy talking about it. And as you know, at conferences you usually get something like 10 to 12 minutes. And so it's very pleasant to be able to talk for something like 5 or 6 hours, like we are going to do today, or maybe 30 minutes. Good. my talk today, I will, so as you see, there is maybe you will see through the talk that I would like to get a message through to you. And that message is first that seasonality does matter. That would be the first thing when we are dealing with climate change, present or past climate change. And the second one that you will see it unfolding throughout the talk is that the buzzword would be mechanisms. And the idea is that every time when we are discussing something like how to link climate change to human activities or environmental change or so, it is extremely important to understand the mechanisms behind these links. If we don't have these mechanisms, then basically we are just putting some data together without really understanding what is happening there. So I might have got a bit over the top of my head here with the talk about, because I said, you know, the dynamics of human societies in Southeast Europe. I have ended up choosing two case studies, two periods. One is slightly outside Southeast Europe. It's from a Bronze Age society in northern Syria, around in Tel Leilan, and the other is from Romania. I will be using these two case studies just to walk you through the idea of how can we use seasonality and past climate change to understand what is happening with societies. And I will start with an introduction. And this is just to show you how I got to these ideas. So let's see, how do I move? Okay, so yes, the question when every time we do something is, you know, why we're doing it. And at least in my case, the most important answer to the question why is just simple curiosity. It's my simple curiosity that it seems that I managed to keep since I was a kid. And I'm happy now that I can answer my own questions. And the second, it's a bit more let's say, applied, is that we are living in this time of rapid climate change. It's a combination of natural and anthropic, and there is a debate of what is going to happen with our civilization in the future if the warming continues. And maybe not is correct to say if the warming, but when the warming will reach certain thresholds. And the discussion has shifted from stopping climate change, which seemed to be always a bit too ambitious, to mitigating it, I mean, how to reduce, and also how to adapt to it. Now, in order to mitigate, to adapt to it, we need to understand how we are, how the climate and how the environment is influencing our society. And to get a better view, we have to go back to the in the past, and we have to have this long-term view. And this recent article tried to put this into a larger frame. You can see it here. It's very nice. It's very complex. I'm not going to walk you through it. But what was missing entirely was the discussion on the mechanisms. And throughout the text, the important thing was this one. Are we using statistical methods for identifying climate-society links? Well, you can use the best statistical methods. You will never identify a link. You will identify a correlation, but you will not get the causality. So this is the important thing. You can have links, but you cannot have causality. And if I'm going back to this question of what is how climate is affecting our society, it is always important to understand what we mean by affecting. Do we mean like a total collapse of the society, or do we mean like how can we adapt to this society, to this to the climate changes? And I will show you just this. Okay, I have to admit somebody. Okay, so I just put this very, very quick web of science search. I've searched for climate change resilience, and you guys, you just on a very quick basic search, you get something like 14,000 hits. And if you look, let climate change collapse, you will get something like 3,000 to 200. So it somehow shows that resilience is more important to us. Now, if you want to understand how we can be resilient, we have to look at past examples. And then if we look at resilience in the Holocene versus collapse in the Holocene, so I just changed, you know, I kept collapse and resilience, you see that people were more interested in the past on the collapse of different societies rather than how they were resilient. And this is because it's simply more interesting, you know, the collapse is more attractive to see how people were disappearing rather than just this kind of adaptation where you just stay in, keep your ground and try to move along, try to adapt, try to mitigate, try to simply live off the land in face of these climate changes. So we need this long-term perspective, and most of the studies were focusing on the, the attractive side of impact that the climate impact had on human societies rather than trying to see how they adapted and how they survived and what their strategies were to adapt to climate change. And in this talk, I will try to show you some examples of what is happening when we go through a moment of climate change. And I will show you two different types of climate change. One that is the abrupt one, and the other is a slower one, and how both of them have impacted the societies that I will that I have looked at. Okay, so the first part I will discuss a bit about this problem of seasonality. So this is a recent publication showing the global mean temperature during the Holocene. You see the time scale from 12,000 years ago until the present, and you can see it shows this well-known early Holocene, cold early Holocene, warming towards the mid Holocene when it got warm, and then cooling towards the late Holocene with the recent warming right here. And as you can see, there are several lines, but the bottom line is that what we see is cooling, warming, and cooling again. Now, the question is, when did this happen? Is this something that happened in all seasons? Was it happening only in one season? Was it specific to summer? Was it specific for winter? And this is extremely important because when we try to understand how climate is impacting human societies, it is important to identify that type of climate change that is really having an impact on that society. So for instance, let's say the case of Israel, where you are now listening to me, I think that it is more important if winter temperatures or winter precipitation, if there is a change in winter precipitation, rather than if there is a change in summer temperature. Maybe the difference between 40 and 42 degrees in summer is not as important as it is the difference between 10 to 12 degrees in the winter. And just to show you what I mean by these seasonal differences, this is a winter temperature reconstruction. It is from Romania, from the ice cave that you have seen in the first image. It shows the delta O18 of ice from 10,000 years ago to the present. And you can see that in the early Holocene, it was a colder period and it started to get warm towards the mid-Holocene. Temperatures stayed rather constant for about 2,000-3,000 years, between 5,000 and say maybe 2,000 years BP, maybe 2,500, and it started a slow cooling trend. Now, if for the same region, we plot the summer temperatures, we get a completely different picture. The early Holocene was warm, it was the warmest maybe, and it started a long-term cooling trend that reached the minimum at around 2,000 years ago, and then it started a slow warming. So we already see this difference between winter and summer. And then if we go further and we look at annual temperatures, we see that these annual temperatures are somehow following the winter ones, and they are completely different from the summer ones. We continue this exercise, and we get to precipitation. So we get maybe an early Holocene, slightly wetter. Again, this is for Romania from the same region. And then we get a slow drying trend. And then we get an increase in precipitation starting around 5,000 years ago and continuing more or less until the present. So we could say, okay, at around 5,000, it started to become wetter. The question is when it was wetter, because again, was it a wet summer? Was it more wet summers? Were there wet winters? And again, these are important, for instance, if you want to understand how this impacted society, because an agricultural society has different requirements in terms of precipitation, winter versus summer. Theoretically, wetter would mean better conditions for crops, but if we think wet summers, these would completely destroy any crops. So you would not benefit from a change into a wetter conditions, like warmer, as you can see here, and wetter. So the final line here shows, again, from the ice cave that I show in the first picture, a reconstruction of the moisture source based on the deuterium excess parameter. The deuterium excess parameter is derived from the delta O18 and delta 2H, and it indicates changes at the source of the moisture. It indicates lower values of the deuterium excess in ice or in water or in precipitation, indicate a humid source, whereas higher values, 12, 14, 16, indicate a drier source. And for our area, based on present day data from precipitation, we know that low DXS in precipitation indicates that the Atlantic Ocean was the main source of precipitation, whereas high values indicate that the Mediterranean Sea was the main source of precipitation. So what we can see on this chart, if we correlate this one and this one, we see that at the time when precipitation started to increase, there was also a continuous increase in the deuterium excess values, which means that at this time, there was a continuous increase of precipitation coming from the Mediterranean. So this wetness that we see here in this record was likely the result of an increase in Mediterranean precipitation. And if we look at modern data, climate data, we know that these Mediterranean precipitations are delivered to the site, to Romania, in late autumn and early winter. So these two combined are telling us that the climate was becoming wetter because winters were becoming wetter. So the summers were becoming drier, very likely, and the winters were becoming wetter. And like this, we get this complex picture of winter temperature, summer temperature, precipitation amount and timing of precipitation. So if we want to understand what happened to a certain civilization or a certain group of people or a culture, we have to look at all these things and have to understand what was affecting them, which of these was affecting them, and how it affecting them. And if there was a possible mechanism explaining the influence of any of these climate change, any of the changes in these climate variables had on that society. Okay, I will now, this is the, just I show this to exemplify how climate can be different from the same region depending on what we actually understand by climate, what type of climate change we're talking about, what climate variable are we considering. And in the next few slides, I will discuss two examples. One will be from Tel Eilan and the other will be from Romania. I will be focusing on this period between 4,500 BP and 3,000 BP with two examples, one an abrupt climate change and the other a continuous but slow change in climate. So these are the two study case studies. One is the Akkadian civilization. It was that around 4,200 years ago collapsed in Tel Eilan. The first studies were done by Harvey Wace back in 1993. And the second will be the impact that climate had on Bronze Age fortifications in Western Romania. These are sites that are being excavated as of now. And if you look at these fortifications and if you look here, you can get an image of the size of these. Very likely these were the largest Bronze Age settlements in Europe. I mean, this, the diameter of this, the smallest of these rampart is about 1 kilometer. And then these people build larger ones with a diameter of maybe 2.5 kilometers. And this is the third one here with a diameter of about maybe 3.3 kilometers. The size of this settlement was exceeding 100 square kilometers. So these were huge settlements and they required extremely large numbers of people to work to build the ramparts around them. And I will walk you through the dynamics of human and climate interactions at the time that these were built. So I will first start with the, okay. I will first start with the Bronze Age society, and I will show you here in red, in top, you will see the line of reasoning that I followed. So first question is, what happened? Okay, what happened is that at 4,200 years ago, Tel Eilan, this tell in northern Syria, the urban civilization around it collapsed in a very short time, and the tell was abandoned for several tens of years. And the question was, okay, why did it happen? Was it a social change, societal change? Was it a climate change? And the leading hypothesis was that this was abandoned because of drought. Now, drought in the region is important. When exactly is it this drought? Is it summer drought or is it winter drought? And I will show you later the how I address this. So this is what happened. It was a collapse of the Akkadian Empire at 4,200 years before present. And the question was, okay, how could it happen? And I anticipated this. I just put this, I took the meteor station in Latakia, the nearest I could find. And you can see that summer precipitations are extremely reduced compared to winter one. So if we are to understand, okay, it was abrupt climate change. What kind of abrupt climate change are we talking about? What had to change in order for this urban civilization to collapse if we are to consider climate change as responsible? And then we have to look at what was important for that agricultural society at that time. And in order to have their crops, it was the winter precipitation. If winters were to become dry, or it was a winter drought, then very likely they would have lost the water required for irrigation and then would have been problematic. Now, if there was a change in summer, like a change from 4.5 to maybe 0 millimeters of rain for several years, that hardly could have had any impact on that society. It's the same for summer temperatures. A change from, I don't know, 27 to 29 on average would have had a much lower impact than a change here in winter. So this is how I think it could have happened. And in order to test this hypothesis, I was looking at the climate change at this time, 4,200 years ago. And this is the record. These are different records. And you can see that indeed at around 4,200 years ago, there was abrupt climate change throughout the Northern Hemisphere. These are different records. This is the Delta 18 from Romania. This is another from Northern Norway. And there is the Caspian Sea. And this is the Middle East in from Jeita Cave, Spiliotem. And then there is from Iran. And you can see that there were strong winds. And what is interesting is that there were these strong winds. There was drought in the Middle East. And there was cold throughout Europe. So yes, there was this abrupt climate change at that time. And one of the recurring features of this climate change was this cold Europe. And then this somehow is at odds with what we think when we think of drought, because drought winds dry and also somehow associated with war. And then we see this cold throughout Europe. And then, okay, we got this climate change. And the question is, how did it change? What exactly changed? And seeing these cold Europe, then I was looking at, okay, what does it take to have cold Europe? And then the only conditions, the most important conditions or the most important factor in having cold Europe throughout, cold winters throughout Europe, in Eastern Europe, in Northern Europe, and also in Central Europe, in the Alps, is that the Siberian high, we have an extension of the high pressure cell above Eastern, above Asia, that extends towards Europe. And it sends this cold, cold air snaps towards Europe. And if we look at the Siberian high, is this high pressure cell that starts to develop in Eastern Asia, and it rolls towards Europe, and the entire Asia and part of Europe is extremely cold. So this strengthening of the Siberian high at 4.2K ago could have explained this cold climate throughout Europe. And in order to test this hypothesis, I was looking at what is happening in present when we have a strong Siberian high. And this map shows the response of air temperature throughout Europe to a strengthened Siberian high. Actually, it's a correlation between the strength of the Siberian high and the winter December through February air temperature. And what this correlation means is that when we have a high Siberian high or a strong Siberian high, then the temperature is extremely low throughout Europe. So you see entire Europe is blanketed in this very, very cold air, whereas the Middle East and Northern Africa is likely very hot. On the other hand, if we look at what the response in terms of precipitation, you can see that is more patchier. So when we have a strong Siberian high, parts of Europe are dry, other parts are wet, extremely wet. And again, here it's a patchwork of wet, and dry. So this is the response of the present day climate to a strengthening of the Siberian high. Okay. If you want to understand what was happening in the past, the question is, can we see something similar in the past? Can we get, if we assume that the Siberian high was responsible for the climatic conditions that we saw at 4.2,000 years ago, then we would expect a similar response also in the paleoclimate record. So I have collected proxy-based climate reconstructions for 4.2K event, and you can see that all are for winter only. this is one of the main problems with paleoclimate reconstructions, because it is very often that in articles or in studies, it is not stated what exactly is being reconstructed or what season that reconstruction is referring to. And these are only records of winter climate only. And here I use the background map. The background map shows what is expected in terms of climate change if we have a strong Siberian high. So we expect it to be cold. And the blue dots show how the climate was at 4.2K BP. And you can see that it was cold, 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 cold everywhere in Northern Europe. There are no records of winter temperature from this part of the world. So we cannot check whether it was indeed warmer here. But the response fits our hypothesis. And if we look at the second map, this is the background again shows the modern response and the dots show the paleo data. And you can see that where we are expecting it to be dry, it was indeed dry. Where we're expecting it to be wet, it was indeed wet. There is, I think this is the only site where there is a mismatch between the paleo data and the expectation. And you can see that there is the data is very consistent. So here is this dry area, and then all these are indicating wet, and you can see the green paleo data is wet, and the background is again wet. So this this paleo data validates our hypothesis because it says, yes, we are expecting it that at 4.2 thousand years ago, a strong Siberian high resulted in drought and wetness throughout Europe and very cold conditions. And the paleo data shows exactly this. Now, the next question is, okay, there is a good correlation between the expectation and the data. And the next step is, okay, we need a mechanism behind it. And this mechanisms is, so yes, it was a very good picture. And then we got this editor decision, yes. So how did it happen? This is the point where we need an explanation, because otherwise we cannot just confidently say that this is what happened. And I've plotted here the winds that are blowing at the time when we have a very strong Siberian high. And you can see that all these winds are coming from east to west. So contrary to the normal flow of winds from the Atlantic oceans towards Europe, the westerlies, at times when we have a strong Siberian high centered over Asia that extends towards Europe, there is a reversal in the winds. They are blowing from east to west. And below you can see the climatic conditions. So this is cold. And we have these winds that are blowing clockwise around this anticyclone. And now what this is telling us in terms of climate at that time is that we should expect dry winds blowing from Central Asia westwards across the Middle East. And then these winds are crossing the Black Sea and they should pick up some moisture there and delivering it in Central Europe. And they would further have to pick up some moisture from the Baltic Sea and dump it here in the southern Scandinavia. Also, at the time of very strong Siberian high, the westerlies are extremely weakened and displaced southwards. And then they are delivering very low amounts of precipitation to southwestern Europe only without reaching further inside Europe. And if you look at, if I just come back to this one, this is the data, the paleo data, and you can see it was dry here, these very dry winds blowing eastward. And then the same winds were picking up moisture from the Black Sea, dump it in Central Europe, picking up some additional moisture from the Baltic and dumping it here in Gotland Island in the middle of the Baltic. And also southwestern Europe was slightly wet because the westerlies, instead of blowing towards mainland Europe, were very weak and did not penetrate further inside the Mediterranean, only wetting this part of Europe. So now we have a mechanism, we have data and we have a mechanism. And importantly, we know that for the agricultural societies that lived near Tell Leilan, winter precipitations were important because these were offering them the water required for agriculture, for, you know, to grow the crops, the grains. And at 4,200 years ago, we had this very strong Siberian high extending westwards, and it was a winter-specific climate change that very likely caused the demise of this urban civilization, and people had to spread in the landscape, you know, habitat trekking, trying to survive there. At the same time, the same strong winds and dry winds likely caused drought in northern India, the site of Harappan civilization, and also in eastern China, where there were Neolithic societies, and all these were also affected. So here and here and here, we have dry winters, and all these societies that were depending on winter precipitation were strongly affected. In Europe, it was wetter, so there was no, there is no evidence for any collapse or any influence on the people living in mainland Europe, because they were not affecting and they were not depending that much on winter precipitation. It was not a problem for them. Okay, and the mechanisms, just further to explain what could have caused this. At the time of this, at the 4.2K, at 4.2,000 years ago, there was a strong gradient between summer and winter insolation, and this caused a weakening of the polar vortex. The winds, the stratospheric winds that are blowing around the North Pole, and this weakening and this weakening of the meander of the jet stream resulted in a more meandering path of it, and this meandering north south very likely displaced southward the storm tracks towards southern Europe, and also the same meandering allowed for the strengthening of the Siberian high somewhere here, and this expanded further eastward, causing this chain of events that was affecting winter climate only and not summer climate. Summers were quite stable at that time with no sign of any abrupt change. So this was a winter phenomenon, and those societies that were depending on winter precipitations were affected, and those societies that were not depending on winter precipitation likely were less affected. Okay, why it doesn't work? Oh, okay, and this is a paper that we published last year, 2 years ago, and you can find it in the Climate of the Past. It's open access, so you can find the entire discussion there in some slightly more detail. Okay, now this was the anatomy of an abrupt climate event and how it could have affected society. I will go now through a different type of change in climate, and I will again show how differences in the seasonality affected a different society. So this is one of the fortifications in Western Romania. There are several sites like this, and this is the region, and these are showing the sites of the paleoclimate data. So here is the winter precipitation record. Here is the summer and the annual, and here is the precipitation record. And modern data shows that there is a very good correlation between the changes that we see in these areas in terms of climate and the changes here. So that means that if we reconstruct the climate from this area, this will also be relevant for this area. And all these sites are showing the same. So the climate reconstruction from this area is relevant for the area here where we have these Bronze Age megasites, like this one here. Now, these developed in a series of phases. So, and I will walk you through the changes in the climate at the time of development and how the people reacted. So they started this is the megasite, the large one. And this was the final stage of evolution for this Bronze Age society. So I put here a quick picture again from the ice cave, because both the temperature and the precipitation record are coming from here. This is a 25 meter thick ice deposit in a cave in northern Romania. You can see here the layering of the ice block. Here you can see it even better. So it's a succession of ice layers with organic matter, pollen, soil derived from the surface. So you can have a very well-dated, radiocarbon-dated, multi-decadal, high-resolution record of climate change for the entire Holocene. And here it is, the period that we are interested in. This period between 1200 and 2200 years before present. Again, below you see the winter temperature record. This is the summer temperature record. And here you see the annual precipitation, the annual temperature, the precipitation amount, and the source of precipitation. And there are three phases, three cultural phases: the Middle Bronze Age, this is the Late Bronze Age One, and this is the Late Bronze Age Two. And this is again already the Early Iron Age. And you will see, so these three, the colors, the shading shows the three phases, and you will see these three lines are placed several tens of years before the start of these cultures. So these cultures, the Middle Bronze Age, started at around 2000 years ago, 2000 BC, and it lasted until 1600 BC. And I put this here and I will explain later, this is the moment that we identified as a moment in a change in climate. Like here it started the climate, the temperature, the winter temperature started to warm, and also the annual temperature started to get warmer. This line is placed some several tens of years before the onset of the Late Bronze Age phase one, when the summer, when the precipitation, the annual temperatures peaked, and also there was a slow change towards colder winters. And again, the red line is placed some maybe 60, 70 years before the onset of the Late Bronze Age II phase, when the winter temperature started to increase. And I will, you will see later, this is also important because when we are, we want to understand the role of climate in the dynamics of society, it is important to understand that it is not always the abrupt moments that are affecting that society. We can have a very slow accumulation of changes that reach a point where the society changes or not. So it is important that these changes could happen quite well before the onset of a change in the society. And I will show you what I mean here. So here are the three phases. The first phase here, where you can see that there were some small tells. So this is the settlements. So there were several tells. And also in between these tells, there were also settled areas that were not surrounded by ramparts or by walls or ditches and so. So they were just small communities living throughout the landscape and several medium-sized settlements. These were something like 5, 6, 7 hectares in surface. At around 1600 BC, these were abandoned. But this abandonment was not an abrupt one. There is no sign of population replacement. There is no sign of war. They simply abandoned these tells, and they just moved in the surrounding landscape. So very likely, they did not have the means to keep these fortifications. There is no change in the number of populations. So based counting the houses, there was no change in how many people inhabited the areas. They did not die or they did not just leave, but they remained there moving in larger settlements, but without fortifications, likely indicating that there was not enough manpower or not enough willingness or people ruling over them in order to have them to build these fortifications. Now, this phase lasted for about maybe 200 years. And then people started to build the huge Bronze Age forts, the ones that were something like, you see the largest, it is not yet sure. We know that the largest that has been documented is something like 100 square kilometers. And we saw some that maybe could be even larger. I mean, extremely large, you see, megaforts, 1700 square kilometers. And these this phase lasted for about 300 years. So people were building this extremely large force requiring an extremely large manpower. And this came to an abrupt end at around 1200 BC when they were destroyed and they were abandoned. And what we did is that we looked at, okay, what happened, especially at the transition? What made these people to build these forts? What made them abandon them and then just start habitat tracking in the landscape? And then what caused them to concentrate again to start building these huge forts? So I placed here again the same. Now you can see the climate conditions, and here it is the historic phases. And you can see that the first phase, when they were building these small settlements, both summers and winters were warm. So it was good for agriculture. And this, the onset of warmer and wetter summers, as well as warmer winters, happened at about maybe something like 40, 50 years before the onset of the building phase. Now, sometimes at around 1600, there was a change, so it became overall cold and wet. So the climate was extremely wet, and it was mostly Atlantic moisture that was coming, and this was making summers extremely wet. So very likely it was very difficult to sustain a complex society when there was not enough food. And we believe that this happened because the summers were wetter, and these wet summers were not favorable for the ripening of the wet. So there was simply not enough food. So people simply moved out of these large forts throughout the landscape. Now, sometimes, and you will see here the red line, sometimes at around 1550, there was a continuous increase in winter temperatures. And also there was an increase in summer temperatures. And also there was an increase in late autumn and winter precipitation. So the winters were becoming warmer and wetter. And at the same time, the summers were becoming drier. And we know that they were becoming warmer. We don't have data to say that they were becoming drier, but we know that from other sites and other paleostudies that in this part of Europe, warm summers are always associated with dryness. So we had an overall increase in temperature, both in summer and in winter. We had a drying of the summers and we had a wetting of the winters. Now, these conditions are good for wet. So we can say, okay, these people were growing wet again, so they would return to the same phase as here. However, they started to build these huge mega forts, and this requires a much larger number of people than in this phase. And there is no sign of people moving in from other regions. So this must have been an increase of local population. And when we were looking for explanations why the same climatic conditions that were active at this time, in this time, they led to an explosion of the population, we found that at the time when the population started to grow here, or let's say at the time when the winters became wetter and warmer, also people started, the inhabitants here, the local population started to cultivate millet. Before that, there was no millet cultivation. And when we look at the climatic requirements for millet, we found that the optimal conditions are warm and wet winters and dry summers. And if these conditions are met, then you can have not one, but two, you can collect millet two times per year, not once. And cultivation of millet, you can see here the red line. So the change in climate towards these ideal conditions for millet and also the first signs of millet appeared some 60 to 70 years before the onset of construction of these megaforts. And we suspect that this 60 to 70 years time period was necessary for the population to grow. So even if there was a change in climate, it was not enough to cause immediately response in terms of construction. It took something like two, maybe three generations of continuous population growth until the number of people reached the critical level at which they could have been put to work to build these settlements. So the main point I want to make here is that it is important not to allow for a societal response to climate change. Do not look directly to a sudden response in terms of what is happening in a society to a sudden change in climate. There could be a change in the climate, but society has an inertia, especially when it comes to a change towards favorable conditions. And this has to be considered when we are looking at the response of this society to a change in the climate. And this this inertia time, it is longer when we are facing favorable conditions, and it is shorter when people are facing some adverse conditions, except for the case there is a volcano eruption or something like this. They take several years, maybe a decade, maybe even several decades, until the conditions, even if they are worsening, are getting to a point where the society cannot continue living the same life, and that has to change. So it is always important when we are looking at times, when looking at these timescales and what was happening and when it was happening, to allow for this inertia of the society. And the second message from here, it is that we have to look at this seasonally specific change in climate. It is important that what climate variable is changing and in what season is changing in order to understand whether it had an effect on the society or not. So I put there, conclusions or the take-home messages, neither of them. And I put this picture just to show that it is important how we grasp a problem. And I will walk you through this because it is important to understand which are the environmental factors that, that are influencing society. So if we don't put the correct answer, then we will not grasp the problem as it has to be, and then we get to some erroneous responses. And always, after we find these responses, we have to understand, we have to find and we have to explain the mechanisms that are linking them. So if you get this very simple sketch, you know, we have the climate, the present climate, we have the past climate, and we have a society. So we need a mechanism to link the past climate to present climate. We have to understand the factors behind present day climate changes, and then we can use this to understand how climate was changing in the past. If we don't know which are the triggers of the change in the climate in the present, it is impossible to understand which were the changes in the past. Second, we need to understand the links between society and climate. And again, the modern links, the present day links, how society, how civilization, how a group of people is living in a certain environment. Which are the climatic factors that are influencing them? Because if we don't know what is influencing them in the present, it is very difficult to understand what was influencing them in the past. If we see, for instance, if we don't know whether summer or winter temperature is affecting a society, then it would be futile to go and say, okay, a change in winter temperature in the past influenced that society, because maybe we know from present day that it was not influenced at all. So we need to understand all these mechanisms in order to understand how climate was influencing society and how it was, how society was responding to these changes in climate, and what can we learn from this for us in the future. Okay, and then the different types of paleoclimate information. It is not always how abrupt they are. It is also important the magnitude of the change, And it's also important the length of that change, because it could be very abrupt, but extremely short, so not enough to influence, or it can be very shallow or very in terms of abruptness, but on a very long time scale, and that could have an impact on it. And then the second, it is important which climate variable we are studying and how it is being expressed. And then, because some of them could have an impact and the others, even if they are very abrupt, for instance, in a desert area, if we have a very abrupt increase in summer temperature, it might not be as, it might not have the same impact as a moderate increase in winter temperature. So it is important exactly what season are we talking about when we are looking at the paleoclimate data. And just, I think, to end, depending on how we grasp this problem, we can end up with this kind of correlation, the perfect correlation, like here shows between the ice cream sales and the shark attacks. But this doesn't mean anything. And if you remember one of the slides of the earlier slides, where people were looking at a statistically significant correlation between different events. Yes, there could be a statistically extremely significant correlation, but in the absence of a mechanism explaining it, we will not get to understand what was changing. And whereas if we understand this and we transform this correlation into causality and to mechanisms, then yes, we can get something like this. Okay, I think I have finished. Yes.
So this thank is you very much, slide. Aurel.
Really, again, the mechanisms.
Really, very good presentation. I really, very much liked it. But I'm biased. I like paleoclimate, you know. I opened the podium for student questions and everybody questions. Actually, there are some in the chat. I will read them. Where is the chat? Mo is asking, what are the cause and effect of climate cooling and warming in relation to climate interaction and human impacts?
Okay. It depends. It depends on, depends, for instance, at what season are we looking at. For instance, if we are looking, so let's say climate cooling. Okay, if we are talking about winter cooling in Europe, it would be the Siberian high, it would be the strength of the Siberian high. So this is where we have to look at it. If we are looking at, warming, then, there is no single answer. It always has to consider the season that we are talking about, because depending on what season are we talking about, then we can have completely different mechanisms at play. So in summer, for instance, we have blocking conditions where you have a mass of tropical dry hot air moving northwards, and this will cause the blocking of the westerlies. And then what we will have is that if this hot air, this high pressure hot air is over Eastern Europe, then this will be extremely hot, extremely dry. 100 kilometers to the west, we will have the westerlies blocked, and these will cause, France and Spain to be extremely wet. So the same continent, the same time, on a space of about 200 kilometers, we can have extreme drought and you can have extreme wetness. So it's a combination of the season that we are talking about and the spatial scale that we are talking about. Or I don't know if you remember the picture that I show with can you still see my screen?
No, we just see you.
Okay, maybe now.
Yes.
So here, you see, so this is the same phenomenon. We have a strong Siberian high, and the response, here it is dry, here it is wet, here it is dry, here it is wet, here it is dry, again wet, here dry, and so on. So it's extremely variable, and this is only for winter. For summer, okay, the Siberian high will have no impact on summer, and then there are completely different mechanisms. So yeah, there is no simple answer at the cause and the effect. So it's a complicated
yeah, I mean, question.
Yeah, it's you have to start with a very, very small and narrow question, you know, and then expand from there. Like, okay, what caused this warming in summer, or what caused the wetness in winter? And then try to understand, you know, to expand in space, because a change in climate in a specific area, it doesn't happen in isolation from any other regions. So for instance, you have a warming in some place, and then you have to look at the neighboring regions to see what was the extent of that warming. And then you move further to see if further afield, was it wet, dry? And then you come up with a hypothesis. This is to explain this warming. This is the hypothesis. This is the dynamic, the climate change that I expect to get this type of response. And then again, you move to that. Okay, so if this is the mechanism, then I have to go to some other areas to check if it's correct or not. So is this moving forward, back and forth between climate and paleoclimate, climate and paleoclimate, and continuously adapting your working hypothesis?
Maybe somebody else wants to ask more questions.
Yeah, I wanted to ask. So you showed the map of. You showed the map how climate affected the settlements. Mm-hmm. Were there any conversation with archaeologists if it's possible to find like new archaeological sites using your data?
You mean to find archaeological sites?
Yeah, using the data. Like, can we rely on that? Or maybe it was already used.
Yeah, so no, we usually, so we work, I mean, the archaeologists are, I'm working with the archaeologists, and they would come up with the chronology of their settlement or settlements or culture. And usually they would either say that, okay, there is nothing that could have happened in terms of climate change to affect this society. And then there are the others who are saying that everything can be explained by climate change. And I mean, both are right and both are wrong, because even today we are living in the environment. We are surrounded by the environment, by the atmosphere, by the hydrosphere. So we cannot live in a total isolation. So then we try to find those explanations in terms of climate that fit the way society existed at the time. So we are looking at how they lived, which were the means by which they were producing food. And then we are looking if the climate changes that we have reconstructed could have impacted their food production systems. If not, then I usually prefer to rule out any influence of the climate. I mean, if I cannot see how the climate could have affected their food production system, it is very difficult to say, yes, climate affected them. Okay, if it did not affect it, mm-hmm. then what did it affect?
Use it post factum, like after you're okay. Yes, thank yes, you. Yes.
Nurit, yes, we were looking at the in Scărișoara ice. We found records, we found the microcharcoal, but not in the main ice cores. So only on the side. So there is a record going back the last 1,000 years where we look at the pollen and macrofossils, and to a very lesser extent to microcharcoal. So yes, not in detail. Not in detail because the record is a bit fragmentary there. So we could not make a very, very good depth age model for that area where we had the charcoal in the ice. So no. In other sediments, yes, in peat bogs and in lake sediments, there are good records of charcoal, but not from that area, not from the area where the megasites are. So the charcoal records are from maybe 300 kilometers away, and those are local. So the people working there are telling me that they cannot say, they can say for sure that there was an, if they see a spike in their charcoal, they can say, okay, there was a increase in the fire activity, but maybe on a radius of about 40 to 50 kilometers, not more. So we cannot extend the charcoal record from these regions to the sites where we have these settlements.
Okay. Okay, cool. So there are more questions? Perhaps. Well, I have many, but I will ask you directly later, because otherwise we're going to swamp to the next hour.
Definitely.
Okay. So, well, I guess that we conclude today. And Aurel, would you like to be contacted for our future seminars?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So there are not too many until the end of the academic year, but we will keep you tuned. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you very much, Aurel. It was really, really, really highly interesting. And we definitely hope that we will be able to eventually invite you to Israel personally rather than virtually. And
I'd love to.
And then you will suffer a little bit of the warm weather that we are having.
Maybe in winter.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay, great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Bye.
Thank you.